So the 50 knot club, hey? That's where it all went down, was in Cowes. Every skipper would be lying and saying that they, you know, they wanted to be the first person to do it.
Don't worry about us.
A boat capable of 50 knots. It's akin to the sound barrier in sailing.
Going this fast, there are dangers.
Straight over the top of USA, that is very close once again.
The wind is the strongest we've seen.
If he keeps improving at this rate, he's going to be challenging.
Debris on the track, under the surface.
We don't normally see them at the back of the start pack.
Tommy Slingsby and his Australian team come out here meaning business.
The race for $1 million.
Hearing them say that we didn't win the last event, things like that, that me off. So there's more friction than we've ever had.
It's like the walls are caving in.
Lura f'Ġunju tal-2019 sar it-tielet avveniment mill-ħamsa pjanati tal-ewwel edizzjoni ta' SailGP. Dan it-tielet avveniment sar f'New York li provdiet sfond tassew impressjonanti anki jekk ħafna mill-professjonisti kienu tassew inkwetati fuq il-kundizzjonijiet tat-temp. Nathan Outridge u Tom Slingsby jitkellmu qabel press conference u l-ewwel taħriġ f'New York. Insegwu.
Honestly, racing in the Big Apple in New York, something pretty special, you know. That venue was super challenging, lots of current, really puffy. The weather wasn't super predictable because it comes straight off the buildings. So normally in sailing, you can read the wind, you can see where there's more wind, where there's less wind, you make a plan, it's pretty obvious. But in New York, you'd be sailing along doing 30 knots, in plenty of pressure, and the next minute, it's like glass in front of you, and you just completely stop. And if you're winning, you do that, and the person following just quickly just tacks and just sails around you.
Gotta do it for the gram.
We have the press conference, and then practice racing today. Weigh-in in the morning, which I've got to get through, and we're racing here in New York.
This series is already building up an incredible rivalry between yourself and Nathan Outeridge. It's one that's been running for a long, long time,
yeah,
though, isn't it?
No, I can't stand it. No, he's, I mean, Nathan and I have been friends for 25 years. We were roommates at the Olympics, but I've got to say, for the first time, I'd say there's more friction than we've ever had. Hearing them say that we didn't win the last event, they lost it, things like that, that me off, and we just want to prove it now that we are a better team, and we're gonna go on with it here.
Take a bow, you've just won here in San Francisco.
The wing display software, so all the information for the start, all the information for the boundaries, all our boat speed, all our angles, completely gone. And I felt very hard done by, to be honest.
We'd been dominating in San Francisco, and so to have that technology failure was a bit of a blow to us, you know. I'm super confident that had everything on our boat been working perfectly, that we were going to continue to go on and to win.
For me, they're just making excuses. You could say that about any event that's ever been done. But we sailed better when it counted, and yeah, it's been a bit of a sore loser.
New York was the midpoint of the season, and already we were seeing Japan and Australia assert themselves at the top of the standings. But behind them, there was a really solid battle for third developing. Dylan Fletcher is as green, if not greener, than Rome Kirby and Billy Besson in the F50. Certainly greener than Rome Kirby, who'd spent time in the AC50. And yet, he'd progressed so quickly. He'd already banked a third in Sydney and a third in San Francisco. And I have no doubt that both Tom Slingsby and Nathan Outridge were looking over their shoulder thinking, if this guy keeps going like this, then he's going to be battling for the championship by the end of the season.
Yeah, San Francisco was such a good regatta for our team. Massive gains from Sydney, although, you know, the result was the same. We were knocking on the door of the Aussies and Japanese, so we're looking to go maybe one or two better here. From Sydney to San Fran, we really studied all the data that we were allowed to look at and looked at ourselves as a team and really focused well in the training. And I think we've got a fantastic group, you know, with Draper and you know, bringing that experience, and even Joe Glanfield, you know, from a slightly different world, who's helped Stuart and I in a 49er, and we really were able to get those processes dialed in, be very productive on the water, and when it came down to it, it showed off in the racing.
Nisimaw li Slingsby jitkellem fuq kif it-tim irid jitlef peace qabel kull tiġrija peress li dan jagħmel differenza kbira l-prestazzjoni tad-dajsa. Jispjega wkoll kif il-membri tat-tim tiegħu jiċċajtaw bejniethom billi ħalsu lil xulxin billi membru jagħżel li jitlef iżjed peace għal membru ieħor.
You have to weigh in before every event. Our team is a bigger team, and so we all have to lose weight. Usually it's a 2, 3, 4, sometimes 5, 6 kilos. In our team, there was a bit of what we call buying kilos, where someone like Kyle Langford always had a very hard weight dip, and he would have a few too many donuts, I guess, in between events, and then would come to the event and he's like, I've got 5 kilos to go. And sometimes someone like Sam Newton, they would sell Kyle a kilo. I'll dip an extra kilo for you, but it's going to cost you. And I think roughly it was about $100 a kilo, or it might have been $200-$300 a kilo.
$300 is not bad for a kilo.
Yeah, but Kyle will pay anything.
Kif diġà rafnikom f'programmi passati, it-teknoloġija tilgħab rol vitali fis-CLGP. It-tim ta' Oracle huwa l-moħħ wara l-ammont kbir ta' data li tasal għat-timijiet waqt it-tlielaq. Din id-data tiġi analizzata minn kull tim rispettiv u minn hemm dan it-tim dejjem jipprova jtejjeb prestazzjoni li jmiss. Ħansegwu dak li kellhom xi jgħidu Nathan Outeridge u Tom Slingsby dwar kif jużaw it-teknoloġija u d-data biex isibu l-bilanċ delikat u meħtieġ bejn il-veloċità u r-riskju.
Technology allows us to make smarter decisions. You know, previously, sailing was a lot of guesswork. It was extremely time-consuming to go on the water and do a bunch of sailing, do some maneuvers or do some straight-line segments and try and work out why you're going fast and slow. The moment, you know, cameras came around and you could start videoing it, well, then at least the sailor could watch the video back and go, oh, I see it from a different perspective now. These days we have a camera on the front of the boat, a camera on the back of the boat. We often try and wear onboard cameras, you know, so we can see what we're doing with our hands and our feet. That's all linked to the onboard communication system. Plus the coach is generally filming from their chase boat. And on race days, there's obviously all the helicopter footage. So there's no shortage of footage now to look at that. Whereas when I was growing up, man, like if I could just see a photo of me and my boat, I was so happy. You know, it didn't exist in the 90s. But now it's not so much using it for Instagram to look cool, but using it to help your performance is what's really going to make the difference.
We want to keep the skill of the sailors as a part of it. We want to keep grinding. We want to keep the physical aspect. We want to keep the technical aspect and also the sort of racing and talent aspect. And so with the flight control, we could make it such a simple system to fly these boats where the boats fly at the same height all the way around the track. We could do that. We could write that software. So we could make them faster tomorrow and make them break 60 knots if we wanted to. But it's a process of blending all these things together and making it the right product. And
it's no longer really about, you know, 50-year-old athletes out there competing. Now the age is getting younger and younger, and you're now seeing 20 and 22-year-old athletes that are actually competing and competing very competitively.
Il-port ta' New York huwa wieħed pjuttost issikkat, ħafna moviment kontinwu b'dajjes ta' kull qies. Bechdel infletxa jispjega kif il-fdalijiet fil-baħar jistgħu joħolqu ħafna problemi għal dawn l-F50s. Jekk waħda minn dawn id-dajjes tolqot sempliċement biċ-ċanjam, faċilment titkisser id-dajsa. U jitkellem ukoll kif għalihom l-iktar ħaġa kera li tista' tiġri illi tinqalib id-dajsa u li wieħed jibqa' maqbur taħt id-dajsa. Insejk.
Quite tight here. Everyone's got their own agenda. We're trying to race. ferries are trying to stick to schedules. Fishermen want to get to the bar.
Dangers in the F50, I guess they're sort of everywhere. You've got debris in the water, which if the foil hits, you know, a bit of wood or something, it will destroy the boat behind it. You know, and you've always got to be on your game for looking out for that.
Oh, what's going on?
But ultimately, the one that I guess is the scariest for us is the boat capsizes and inverts, then you're underneath this boat. You've got this big trampoline net and you're going to have to try and escape. And we've done all our safety training and we've been taught how to use it all, but it is something that no one, I think, can really explain to you how scary it is being put underwater in the black.
Slowly bringing her up. Hold on.
Nejten għawtriġ u Tom Slingsbiet kelmu dwar l-importanza li wieħed ma jeżaġirax u dejjem iżomm il-bilanċ delikat bejn il-veloċità u r-riskju.
We did say that morning someone's going to tip it over today because we could see how hard everyone was starting to push. And the harder you push, the more the boat's going to bite you back. And it's like, again, analogy in motorsport, when you're trying to like push out good lap times to get a good qualifying, someone's going to spin off the track into the wall. And that's effectively what the British did there.
Well, Ed, we were just talking about what a tough place this is to sail. With these big stinger puffs, we can see them coming off the city here. And one's already blown one of the teams over. Unfortunately for the British tuning in, GBR, they're already out.
There's people out there that sort of didn't really realise how dangerous this was. I think, and I don't think I'm saying this in a bad way, but for example, Phil Robertson in his first season with Team China, he was crazy out there. Like, we were scared of him on the racetrack. We're like, he doesn't really understand how these things bite. I think that was a bit of a defining moment for him to realise that these boats will bite back.
3 minuti qabel l-ewwel tillieqa, Team Britanniku ta' Sail GP mat-tela tagħhom għall-kosta inqabdu mir-riħ u inqalbu fuq ġenb. B'hekk huma kellhom jibqgħu barra l-ġurnata kollha. Ħanisimgħu lil Dylan Fletcher dwar din l-esperjenza.
Yeah, so today was the first day in New York. We've had limited training, but we kind of knew what to expect today with the conditions, and we had sort of 15 to 20, 25 knots, and we had just doing our normal sort of pre-start training, and unfortunately we got hit by big gusts. Someone was saying something like 37 knots, but I'm not sure. The boat started going up and down, and we couldn't quite catch it, and we ended up capsizing, which obviously was bitterly disappointing to end our day's racing, but the main thing is that everyone was intact, and we did a really good job with the safety team to get the boat upright quickly and save it. So fingers crossed we'll be racing tomorrow, but yeah, gutted to be honest, very upset about it all.
Issa sensegwu ftit azzjoni fis-serje ta' tlielaq. Il-port ta' New York żgur ma kienx wieħed ideali peress li l-korsa hi pjuttost sajra u b'riħ varjabbli immens ġej minn kull direzzjoni.
Here we go. This is for all the bragging rights and the overall victory here in New York City.
There's no way to possibly explain the way we're trying to get through this today. I've never sailed in conditions like this in my life. I don't think on a boat like this.
And we are off and racing. This racetrack is so small and the wind is all over the place. And through the finish line, the very, very relieved bunch of sailors there. A little bit of relief. Second. Take second pretty much every day, wouldn't you? Unless Australia's in front of you. They're pretty happy. They're going to set up for their second win of the day. Very, very relieved bunch of sailors on that boat, that's for sure. USA, ladies and gentlemen, get up and clap, because there it is.
Nice job, boys. Nice job, guys. Way to tough it out. Let's go, keep racing. I red flagged it.
He'll get a penalty for that, surely. It's huge contact there.
They've said flag.
Penalty Australia.
Penalty Australia, so Australia have to get in behind Japan. Shirley, straight off the cuff, we have a drama. Japan, leading, coming into the first mark.
Coming up in three,
Stay on this tack.
One.
And Australia have got in front of Japan to have a nice healthy lead, so they got into that breeze first.
Tom Slingsby, he is a master at it, a real kind of street fighter.
Big one up.
Good puffy, goods.
Australia done a nice job keeping in front of Japan, but they have stopped in the water.
Nothing I can do here.
So you're right there, Shirley. Japan have got it. Up and foiling in Japan, so lead change, ladies and gentlemen. Japan now in front. Australia hating life right now. He needs to get that pressure, get them bows away and start chasing Japan.
One hole.
Which mark is he going to go?
He's going to go right.
Nathan's pretty happy that he's going to get up and go to the right-hand side. Yeah. All that will be running through his head now is revenge.
Okay, I've got it.
Yours, man.
Jody, the Japanese are flying to this bottom gate for the last time, over 30 knots.
My right.
One, standing up.
Yeah, boys.
Japan are just about to win here in New York City. Well done, Japan. That is quite an effort.
Yeah, boys. Go!
They swallowed it. They've copped it. They've come here to New York City. Revenge was always their catch cry, and they have taken revenge. There's no doubt about it.
Ir-rekord ta' veloċità ta' tbaħħir bejn it-tmeninijiet u madwar l-2010 kienet kważi esklusivament fidejn il-windsurfers u l-kite boarders. Id-dajjes tradizzjonali qatt ma setgħu jilħu dawk il-veloċitajiet u lanqas jaslu viċin sakemm fl-aħħar 10 snin bl-introduzzjoni tal-foils kollox inqalib ta' taħt fuq. Illum il-ġurnata qed naraw dajjes kbar ibaħħru bħal qatt qabel li jilħu veloċitajiet ta' 50 knot. Fil-fatt wara li ntlaqgħet din il-veloċità fis-Sail GP ġi introdott il-50 knots club.
So the 50 knot club, hey? That's where it all went down, was in cows.
I was surprised, actually. I thought the 50 knot barrier would be broken in San Francisco, and then when we got strong winds in cows, you know, I was pretty certain that it would be broken.
As the way that Sail GP had sort of developed, the home team will always get the first day training on their own, and we said, okay, fair enough, we get it. It's fine. But the moment that the wind was in that wind range and the 50 knot barrier was up for grabs, I think every skipper would be lying and saying that they, you know, they wanted to be the first person to do it.
We had a day's practice racing on the Wednesday, which is actually my fondest memory of cows, because we did two practice races, we won both comfortably, and there was still thousands of spectators that had come out to watch. To be honest, we nearly pitch bowled the boat on the way in, trying to hit 50 knots, but we just did it, and we hit 50 knots, and we didn't even realise at the time we weren't looking at the speedo, we were just head down, just focusing, holding on for dear life.
So we've had a look at the data again using the second GPS on board, high frequency, and recalculated the boat speed using that, and for a burst of speed, you broke the 50 knot.
50 knot club.
And Dylan obviously took it on to wind everyone up as much as he could, saying, you know, that they were the first to do it, and even went to the point where riding it on the boat, 50 knot club, and yada yada.
I was thinking about that. I was like,
And I just, with our boys, I just laughed and said, yeah, it's all right, we'll just do it tomorrow.
I reckon we can join the 51 knot club. What do you reckon, Yuki?
I would say 50 points, we.
Everyone's been chasing it. It sort of was one of those things that everyone knew was going to happen at some point this season.
Yeah. Oh, it was a marginal break. I definitely wouldn't have signed the boat.
I mean, they say they broke it, but I haven't seen the data.
Did they?
I guess it's as Russell says, it's not in racing, it doesn't count.
Because we're sitting here on shore and it's not really a fair playing field that we're not allowed to be out there training with them, so I mean, they're given all the tools to break it, and we're not, so that's the way I think of it.
It was insane to do it, and to do it in cows, you know, was a huge deal for us. We're just trying to get one over the others. Does it mean something? Yeah, it kind of means something, but it only meant something because they wanted to do it more than we did.
Every time I look at you, I see it in your eyes. You're pretty, yeah, but no, not like diamonds in the sky. I look into your soul, don't like what I can see. But you can make me whole, piece by piece, you've broken me.
Issa sendura l-avveniment li sar f'Cowes fl-Ingilterra, fejn ġew ikkanċellati t-tiġrijiet kollha minħabba temp. Iżda l-kundizzjonijiet bir-riħ f'Cowes irriżultaw f'rekords ġodda fil-veloċitajiet tad-dajjes. Rajna wħud mill-F50s jiksru 50 knot barrier. So
don't you worry. Looks like they're gone now. The tip of the wing is in the water. So the USA in. We're going to stay with the racing. All the focus has been on the British team getting the first 50 knots, winning the two practice races. Oh my God. You just see Chris. He literally just got thrown over. The only thing saving him was his tether. Australia are about to take the first win for event number four here in Cowes.
And they touched 50 knots.
Got to be careful here, USA. That's amazing that that boat is up and racing. I can't believe they are. Australia nailed the start in the middle. Great job there by Tom Slingsby. We've got a broken pedestal here on Japan.
Now look at where we are. Can you see how far we've come? We moved but never left. Guess it's over, yeah, we're done. You said we had it all.
You both have got penalties for sailing over the boundaries. That is Australia, China and America. So when they start, they will have to slow down.
Come on, come off, boys! Yeah. Make sure I keep going, yeah. We can't until it's all
fall. Clean up all the pieces. I clean up after you. Until my love decreases.
Every single boat had an issue, and they've got through it amazingly.
The difference between racing as an amateur, where you still face a lot of pressure at the events, but it's not your career. And when you know that your career's on the line, it adds a dimension that a lot of people haven't experienced before. Professional sports can be tough. It can be cutthroat. It can be ruthless, you know. And for all of the sailors that get selected on board these boats, there's probably a list of sailors underneath them that would love the chance to get in and do it. So there's probably some that are hoping that they succeed, and there'll be some that are hoping that they don't.